My name is Allison Esri, and I'm the chair of the CSPG Stanley Slipper Award Committee. I'm really pleased to be here with Dean Potter, who is the winner of the 2020 award, and with CSPG members, Mandy Williams, who submitted the nomination for Dean, works for Burgess Creek Energy, as well as Jason Frank, who is from Athabasca Oil, who is on the CSPG executive. They're going to join me to ask Dean some questions today. Before I turn it over to Mandy, I want to mention that the Stanley Slipper Gold Medal is among the highest honors awarded by the CSPG. The medal is presented for outstanding contributions through the application of petroleum geology to petroleum exploration and development in Canada, or by Canadian-based petroleum geologists working internationally. Dean's a really deserving recipient of this award, given his impact on Saskatchewan oil and gas industry, through the pursuit of his geological ideas with a series of entrepreneurial ventures and startups. This resulted in some very successful exploration discoveries and campaigns, particularly in the Williston Basin. Dean's been previously recognized by the Saskatchewan industry. In 1991, he was awarded Oilman of the Year, and in 2019, he was inducted into Saskatchewan's Petroleum Industry Hall of Fame. I'll refer everyone to Dean's citations that are available on the CSPG Bulletin, or website, and in the Reservoir in the Bulletin. And at this point, I'm going to pass it over to Mandy to begin some of the questions.
All right. Well, thanks for being here today, Dean. One of the questions I want to talk to you about is, as an experienced geologist, what do you believe are the necessary tools for a successful career in petroleum geology? And how have these tools changed through the past, present, and future?
Well, thank you, Mandy. Before I answer your question, let me just say thank you. Thank you very much to the CSPG for this honor. And thank you for the people that nominated me, including Mandy. There are some very, very, very good friends that I've worked with in the business that nominated me, and I can't thank them enough. And let me tell you, it is quite an honor to be included in that list of people who have had this honor since 1989, and I can't thank you enough for that. So to answer your question, Mandy, what are the necessary tools to be successful as a petroleum geologist in this business? And I don't think there's any difference in the past, the present, or the future. It's all about, to me, it was all about education. I had a thirst for knowledge, and self-directed education never stops. I still am reading and studying as much as I did when I was in my 20s, and because it's such a fabulous career and it's such an interesting topic. And so what's a necessary tool is you have to be self-directed. You have to, we all went to different universities, and I think we all had different starts at different universities, but it really comes down to what you did yourself and how you trained yourself. I had the very fortunate experience to be able to do field work, which I think really set me up for being a geologist and being able to think as a geologist outside of the textbook. I also went on after my education was very much related to economic geology and structural metamorphic geology, and I went on to do a postgraduate in economic geology in Precambrian Shield, and that was probably the most important thing in the whole process, was that it taught me how to understand the question, formulate all the facts or put all the facts into perspective, formulate a model, and arrive at conclusions. And really, anybody who's been successful in this business knows that's what exploration is all about. You don't just go wandering out there picking tops. You have to have a model, and that is my secret to success is having that model. So the past, it's no different than today. I would say don't get distracted by too many other disciplines. If you want to be an exploration geologist in classics, be a very good exploration geologist in classics or carbonates or a structural geologist. Be the best you can be, and that'll take care of a lot of the issues in working in this business.
Thanks. Yeah, so a lot of your success and a lot of your career has been spent in the Williston Basin. Why did you choose to focus there?
Well, I started with a company called Saskatchewan Oil and Gas, or Sask Oil. I decided that the mining industry was too tough to find a job in, and so I eventually ended up in Sask Oil with a wonderful bunch of people. And of course, they were working in the Williston Basin, or at least I got put into the Williston Basin and worked in Saskatchewan and in Manitoba. And that was fine, and I love that part of the basin and all the geology that goes on there, but I just had a thirst for you. I heard about on the other side, I read that there are Silurian fields, there are Cambrian fields down there, there are impact craters, there are Pennsylvanian fields. What is all this? I don't see any of this on the Canadian side. So I had this thirst as to what went on the other side. And so eventually I was allowed to start doing some mapping on that side. And then as soon as I got over the fence into the US side, then I looked at the basin as a whole, the whole picture, the whole thing, 360 degrees. And there's hardly a pool I haven't looked at in that basin. And so that was my thing. I loved being able to be, to know everything I could about the pools and the geology of that basin, and I still can't get enough of it. That didn't preclude me from doing lots of work in Alberta, in the U.S. Rockies, and I even had a stint in the Persian Gulf. But I always came back to Williston Basin because that was sort of my home base that I really loved.
Thanks. Well, like you said, it's good to focus on your strengths and where you really want to be. So you've been in the industry for a long time. Can you tell us a bit about the boom and bust cycles that you've been through and how you've adjusted to the downturns?
Boy, you're right. Boom and bust cycles are part of this business. And I guess that when all of us started thinking about going to university and taking geology, I don't know that we really thought that we were getting into a business like that. But the fact is, that is the business we're in. We're in a commodity business, and we're at the whims of all those different factors, all the way from demand and supply to politics, to international politics, to Canadian politics, everything, and just plain corrections in the stock market. Every one of those, and any one of those, can sneak up in at any time, and it causes so much pain in the business when that happens. But let's start at a bust, let's talk about a boom first. And so, you know, what does a boom look like? A boom looks like where everybody's changing jobs, there's a record number of drilling rigs, and the price seems to be a little bit higher every day, and that's when you have to get suspicious that this isn't going to last, because it never does. It never does. And as soon as you've seen it a few times, you know what to expect. And I hate to sound negative, but it's true. That's what happens. So then you go into a bust. And the bust, like I said, it can be business, it can be politics, it can be international, as in the Arab embargo back in the 70s. It can be all kinds of different things that can cause it. But you're part of it, and you're in it. And you're looking sideways at all the people that you work with, and you think, where do I fit in this whole thing, and how am I going to get through it? I've got responsibilities at home, and I've got a career ahead of me. How am I going to get through this? And so I'll just take my example. In sort of the 85 to 1990 bust was awful. It was probably as bad or worse than this one. And what I can say is that I never stopped the education. The education kept going. In fact, maybe it even accelerated. I didn't get distracted by negative sentiments. So I was working hard at doing exploration. I thought my employer, the shareholders of the company I work for, don't really want to drill my prospects, but someday they might, and so I better be ready. And so I was a pretty busy guy putting prospects together in spite of the fact that it was there was a lot of negative sentiment around that why do we even need these things? So it comes down to my theory that successful exploration is a product of a good exploration model. And so I'll give you an example. In the 85 to 90 bus there, I went down into Montana, North Dakota, and mapped the deep fields and did that so that I knew exactly what those Ordovician fields were, what made them tick. And so then when I knew it from a stratigraphic point of view, backwards and forwards, what those fields looked like. And I guess that if it would have been a busy time, I wouldn't have had that opportunity, but I had the opportunity. So then I came across the border, and probably the day that I ended up coming back across the border and looking in Saskatchewan, there was such an obvious prospect sitting there, and bingo, it was a discovery. So you can see how, don't let it get you down. You have to be ready for, because good times will come back. They will come back. And the last thing you want to do is get in that funk with the whole business that the business is upside down. That's not going to help your profession any.
Yeah, and I know you've told me in the past stories about this and how really the dedicated and passionate people, they all come back, and that it's the more you work on your craft and the more you focus on your efforts, that does pay off. So thank you. On the topic of mentors, can you tell us about the value of being mentored by others and your decision to be as knowledgeable as possible in subjects like geophysics, land acquisition, downhole engineering, and also what subjects you intentionally avoided focusing your efforts on?
I think I'm going to start to answer that question by answering the last part of your question. And then, so it sounds kind of negative, the things I didn't want to become an expert at. And it sounds like an odd comment. I wanted to be the best geologist I could be, and the only way I could do that would be to understand all the aspects, everything that went around in the world that I was working in. And so I worked with geophysicists, I worked with engineers and with business people. But I'll tell you one thing that the one thing that I didn't do was I didn't get drawn into the understanding of the engineering part of this business. And that's not negative in the slightest. I wanted to be the best geologist I could be, and I wanted to work for the best engineer that I could work with. And so I thought, I'm going to be the best I can be, and I hope that my employer puts me with the best engineer that is out there, and we can together do very well. So although I do understand the downhole pumping, the mechanical parts of the batteries, and all, I understand that because I do have a mechanical background, but from a point of view of being a geologist, I thought, I'm going to leave that to those experts, and I'm going to be an expert in my field. And so mentors. You know, I had some wonderful mentors when I started in the business. I don't think there were anyone in that company that had more than 5 years experience. And when we thought when we had 3 years experience, we were pretty hot. We were the best. And so the mentors just didn't really exist there. There were some great people to work with and teach each other, but we didn't have those mentors. And I got picked to go and meet this fellow who was probably my stage in his career. And his name was Norman Cowper. And they sent me to see this fellow in Victoria to spend a few days and just soak up some of his knowledge. And if you look at the references to Norman, he wrote a lot of Devonian papers back then. And that was an eye-opener to meet someone like that who was just full of information. We spent 2 or 3 days going through everything he knew about the Alberta side of the basin, which was fabulous. So it taught you what you didn't know and how you needed to learn that. So then there were other people. There was a fellow that became a very good friend. His name is Don Kissling, and he was a carbonate geologist, lived in Colorado, And he was a wonderful mentor. And so I would draw on him all the time. And so he taught me so much carbonate geology. But I think the best thing that person ever taught me was that he would stop me and say, just a minute, Dean, you haven't got enough facts and you're arriving at conclusions. So you have to go back and get your facts straight. And I know where you're heading, but your facts aren't straight. And what a great way to be taught in this business by somebody graciously like that, telling you how to stop and think. And then I worked with a mentor in the business side. I worked for a mentor. His name is Ted Renner, and he was my boss when I went to Precambrian Shield, which became Mark. That was such a start to work for someone that was a business mentor. He was an engineer, but he was a business mentor. And the stuff that I learned watching that guy, in the way that he ran the company, just led me through my career. It was impressive, the way that the thought process went. So I can't tell you enough how much mentors are to this business. And then I'll say that, there are so many other brilliant geologists that I worked with, and I became commonly sharing ideas with, that were parallel to me. U.S. geologists, I spent a lot of time in the U.S. with those geologists and exchanging ideas, and so that was such a big thing. And so I've been lucky to have some very, very impressive people to teach me along the way. And then that leads me to today. I guess I don't have too many mentors. I'm probably at the end of my career, but I really enjoy mentoring other people. And Mandy can agree with that. I'm sure that it's what I really enjoy now, is being able to take people and explain the business or explain stratigraphy to Mandy. And my son Jamie works in the company too. And so it is a pleasure, and it's an honor to be able to be a mentor to other people now. So.
Well, thanks, Dean. It's a pleasure and an honor to work with you and be mentored by you as well. So thank you. Last question for me is, knowing what you know today about markets, if you were new to the industry today, would you be worried about your career aspirations as an exploration geologist? In that, is there a future in the oil business, and is there oil left to be found?
I can answer the second part of that question first, like I did last time. Yes, there is oil to be found. Yes, the easy stuff was found, and I guess that if we went back to the back to when I started in the business, a lot of people would have said that it was the oil business and discoveries in Canada or the Williston were something of the past. But that's not true. There still are a lot of subtle prospects. You can't find it as easily as you could in 1965 or something, when they were finding those big fields. But there definitely is more. There's definitely more exploration to do. I would say that today, in Saskatchewan, maybe even more in Alberta, that place, that basin is just lying fallow. There's no activity going on, and the land is all available. I guess, as using the expression, the table set, is so easy to picture where you could find more oil and gas in Saskatchewan, but more particularly I would say in Alberta. And it's just that we need to have a market that gives the capital to go drill that stuff and to apply the exploration. Is there a future as a geologist in this business? Well, I guess that my first answer answers that one. And yes, there is. Yes, there definitely is. Maybe it won't be as easy as when I started in the business. It was quite the demand for geologists, and it was people could advance quickly. People have moved around companies a lot because there were a lot of jobs available, but nevertheless, is there a career? My advice on that one is there is a career, but you have to figure out where you want to be in that career. Because I guess in the 80s or 90s, you could get a job as a geologist and you probably could work till you were ready to retire and not really think about that. But today, I think you have to think about it. The jobs aren't as plentiful, the companies aren't out there. And so you have to have a plan as to I'm going to use me as an example, I'm going to be an expert in the Williston. I'm going to learn everything I can about that so that there's nothing that I can't accomplish there. Or you'd be an expert in the Devonian in Alberta, or you'd be the expert in the Montney. You'd be valuable with your what you knew about oil sands. And so I think you have to figure out who you are and where you want to go, because it isn't just sort of a conveyor belt through your career anymore that maybe those of us of my age were able to follow. If you're going to have a successful career, you're going to have to plan it.
Yeah, I think a lot of people are in that position, figuring out where they fit in and where their strengths lie. So thanks.
And if you have a plan, people see that, and I think people will lead you forward. But if you don't have a plan, I don't think that somebody that wanted to be in oil sands should suddenly try to convince someone that they can explore for the Ordovician in the Williston, because that there's a little bit of a gap there. So whereas before you could move around, I think now it's you better be more specific.
Yeah, like you've mentioned when we've talked about this before, there's no one holding your hand anymore, or ever was really, but yeah, everyone.
There is no one. No, there. It's up to you. It's personally up to you to educate yourself and to motivate yourself, and you'll stand out. If you do that, you'll stand out, and people will recognize it.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Dean. I'm going to pass off the questions to Jason Frank now, and he's going to talk a little bit about business and your experience there.
Okay.
Hi, Dean. I just wanted to say what an honor it is to be across the virtual table with you today, and just such a treat to hear your stories. So my first question is about business, and it's really about the special quality that you possess. And I guess it's that amazing geological skill set, but combined with your business acumen and your business skill set. Could you lead us through your steps on how you got into business and maybe how you see business evolving in today's world and going forward?
Okay, well, if we start back early, the first 5 years or so when I was in the oil industry, I think I was, you know, you're working as a geologist for an employer, and you've got some, they're giving you some specific tasks to do, and you're learning every day, and that was all good. But I think I always had in the back of my mind that I would like to venture out on my own sometime in my career. In that thought process, it wasn't for a monetary gain or riches. It was for the personal satisfaction of being able to have my own, be supporting myself in this boom and bust world that we work in. And so it was always in my mind that somewhere along the line I would do that. But I knew back then that I was way too inexperienced to ever do anything like that. And so I guess I went through those 20 years or whatever until I started off my own, just absorbing all that information about how a business works. And so as a geologist starting out, when you saw an annual report, you wanted to look for the maps in the annual report. But then, you know, as you got further on in your career, you realized that it's not the maps, it's the business part. And so you better understand that. And so you gradually transform in what's important and what you don't know. And if you want to be in business, you better understand that stuff. And I guess a lot of people I worked with would have gone on and done an MBA, but I guess I did the personal one where I just learn as you go, and it was so much fun doing that. And so 20 years, I learned a lot. I saw a lot of the good and the bad, the way decisions were made, the way that businesses were run. I saw all that and took that all in. It was in my mind as to what I would do if I ever had my own business, what I wouldn't do if I ever had my own business, and how I would treat people that work for me. And so I was sort of getting to the point where I would maybe be interested in starting on my own. And then the company I was working for up to the late 90s, it didn't have a happy ending. I can tell you now that over disagreement, I actually got fired. And I got fired, and I would consider it was business ethics, business professional ethics that I got fired over. And so I can proudly tell you that was a happy ending to that story. And even though it wouldn't appear that way. So then that day that I left there, I knew that it was time to practice what I preach, what I wanted to do. And it was the 1998 tech bubble burst there. And so the price of oil went to $10. It wasn't exactly the best time to be starting out in business. And so I started, I incorporated a company and here we go. I'll talk to friends that I used to work with or companies I used to work with, and I'll consult for them, and we'll build this up. And you know, it didn't happen. So I started, there's one of the best geologists I've ever met is Steve Halabura. He and I started teaching this or giving this course on prairie salt solution to companies like Talisman and Nexen, and then, you know, and so that was a little bit of cash flow. And then eventually I was overbooked as a consultant, and I had my own office. I didn't work in someone else's office, and that's very important advice to somebody today. If you want to be a consultant, do you want to work in your own office, or do you want to just be in someone else's office? There's a big difference in the two, and I didn't do that. Next thing you know, I was flat out working as a consultant, and I was having so much fun. And it's like I said to Mandy, you step out on your own, and you've got that no paycheck day. So comes the end of the month, there's nobody sending you a paycheck. That's pretty scary. And then how pleasing can it be when suddenly you've got, you're completely taking care of yourself on your own, and you've got a bunch of wonderful people, different diverse companies you're working for. It couldn't be better than that, you know. And so that one in the morning, I might have been working up on the Peace River Arch. In the afternoon, I may have been down working in the Powder River in Wyoming, and then getting ready to go over and map this Mishriff Cretaceous field in the Emirates. How could it possibly get better than that? You know, that was so much fun. But the thing is, there were a lot of really fine people that I consulted for too, and that I respected. So there I got that start, and then I always had this connection with the U.S. Williston and some good friends down there, and I'll one person in particular, Clark Crawford. He taught me how to sell prospects and how to sell prospects for an override. And that became my other company. My consulting company was called Cito Geo Consulting. Then I started my own other company called DPX Inc., which was the royalty company. And so there I was. I was on the way. So then I came back from a tour in the Middle East and decided I want to get back into working with people again. I'd worked for myself and had one employee, and I wanted to get back to working with people, with geologists and geophysicists and engineers and all that. And so I started a company, and the interesting thing is that all went so successful. It was the boom of private equity that was flowing at us, and so I definitely benefited from all that. But I'll tell you one thing that was interesting when I got in business, and at that time it was a lot of money. We raised over $30 million, and I asked one of the private equity companies that was a big backer. I said, you look at 10 deals for every one that you invest in. Why did you invest in me? Why did you invest in me? And his answer was spontaneous. It was, well, you had your own little business and you succeeded at it and it's still running. So what else would we go on? And isn't that interesting that my little consulting company and my fledgling royalty company was actually led me to those pastors. It was very interesting, and I never looked back. So that's how I got in business, and it was the best thing I ever did when that day when I got pushed out and had to. I might call it the best day of my career when I got pushed out and it was time to do what you always wanted to do. And of course. Of course, I had a family that supported that crazy idea.
Oh, right on. No, that's interesting, Dean. I mean, all these nuggets. I mean, I really hope, you know, people can watch this interview and get some of this from you. It's just amazing. I'm going to switch gears a little bit on my next question and talk about some of your accolades, I guess. And, you know, being presented with the Saskatchewan Oilman of the Year in 1991 and being inducted into the Saskatchewan Oil Industry Hall of Fame in 2019 and now the Stanley Slipper Award by the CSPG in 2020. Is there a common thread or a common theme through those awards that you think? Is there something that ties all of those together?
Well, I guess that the common thread would be working in the Saskatchewan industry, and you know that was it. I'm very grateful for all the opportunities I was given there, and grateful that I was able to connect that with the U.S. industry and become part of that. That was a wonderful part. But I guess that what connects the three? Well. Mandy said she suggested it was risk, and I would put first in front of that would be passion. I just couldn't get enough of it. I couldn't get enough of exploring, and understood. I was always into a different part of the basin and figuring out what was going on there, and then bringing that idea back to where I was. And so someone might have said, what's the value of understanding a Pennsylvanian play in the southern end of the basin, or understanding a Cretaceous play in the Persian Gulf? I think it all comes back to, it's just in your head, it's just knowledge. And so it's that passion to learn and passion to practice it, you know? And so that was, I put that first. And like Mandy said, I guess that I did have I guess the one thing that does connect it was that I did have a tolerance for risk. And you know, and I said in that when we started up the business that I started the consulting company and you know there was lots of risk in doing that, and then there started the royalty company, and there's lots of risk in that. But the biggest risk, I guess, was when I was buying land and selling my prospects. You know, I can tell you that I significantly on more than one occasion mortgaged the house to pay for that land, and with a family living in that house. That was how I got there, and I don't think I could have got there if I hadn't taken risks. But believe me, that's not what I'm telling anyone else to do. That was a personal thing, and I think that most of the people that are on that list of the Slipper Award, they've been there. They've been there and taken those risks. You didn't get there with a free ride. So passion, risk, and then just the other one is just the business of people. All those awards go with the people that I've worked with and the people that I'm friends with that are from the past and today. It's what a wonderful group of people I've worked with, and they all connect that. They all connect those three awards. So as an example, one of the people in the nominations for the Slipper Award was a person who had an office next to me in 1981. You know, that's how far back it goes. And so risk, passion, and the people that I got to work with who were wonderful. I think that answers it.
Yeah, that's amazing, Dean. Thanks. That's an incredible story. And gosh, it's just been a real treat to ask these questions to you today. I'm going to hand over the mic now to Allison, and I think she'll finish off the interview. So thanks again, Dean.
Okay.
I think we may have lost Allison. So we'll just wait for her to come back in. But I'll start off with one of the questions she had on her list here, Dean, is what would you say are the best moments in your career?
Can we, so that's a plural then, okay?
Yeah, sure, or one or more, go ahead.
Okay, well, I guess, I think I've said this before, that when I was early in my career, I think I worried that I could go through my career and not find something meaningful. And I guess, I don't know why I worried about that, but when I was maybe 5 years in, I thought, what if I went through this career and I got paid handsomely by my employer and with a pat on the back every year, but I never found anything. How embarrassing would that be? And so it was in my mind all the time that I've got to get a discovery behind me so I can get that off my back. So I guess one of the best moments was when, I think it was 1989, when on a day that's as cold as today, we made the discovery of that Ordovician discovery in Saskatchewan. I've accomplished that. And, you know, the reserves of that field and the economics of it weren't spectacular. The fact that we found Ordovician oil in Saskatchewan led to another boom, and that was fun. But I guess who else has ever made their first discovery in their career and had their dad there with them when they pulled the core? That was pretty neat, because my parents lived in southern Saskatchewan. My dad came with me to the lease and was there with me when we pulled the core. That was pretty neat. Don't think too many people have that on their in their memory. The best moments of my career. Well, I guess, you know, like I said, it wasn't a happy ending when I left that one company, but that was the best thing that ever happened. That was the absolute best thing that ever happened. And I think that a lot of the people, the wonderful people I worked with there, I think they kind of wandered after that. Not because I wasn't there, but I'm not sure that they didn't drift a little bit. And I was able to pick it up and run with that. And so I'm happy that that happened, because it gave me the stimulus to get going. And then the other best moments in my career is still today, when I get to, and I know Mandy can agree with this. I love teaching what I know to younger geologists now. That's pretty fulfilling to be able to explain the business and the geology to younger people. What could be more satisfying at the end of your career than to be able to teach people? So I guess those would be that's a list of three. There are probably more.
Well, thanks. I had not heard that story about your dad being there pulling the core. So that's a good one. Maybe you'll be able to do the same one day with Jamie. Wouldn't that be fun?
It was a Winnipegosis karsted core. It was pretty neat. It's pretty neat.
Yeah. Wow. That'd be a good one to see. Another question here from Allison is, what led you to pursue a career in geology?
You know, that's a tough one to answer. I think, you know, you as a young person, you see adults ask them, well, what are you going to do in your life? What are you going to do? And so everybody's asking you that. And and so you're looking at all the options, and you see something, oh, this could be interesting. I'm not sure what a geologist does to make a living, but this is an interesting science. And so you end up taking geology classes. And so I think I'd be like a lot of geologists that just kind of got in the shallow end and started from there. I'm not going to tell you that I started because I wanted to be an exploration geologist working in this state or that province. I did definitely not that. Because it was just interest in the world around me, and that, you know, I don't think back then that people got in because they heard that there were fantastic jobs. It doesn't really happen. That was 1971, I think. I don't think that was really happening then. So I guess I probably got in for the right reasons. So. That's a little different than you maybe expect. You might think that I wanted to be a mining geologist, or I wanted to go work in far places in the world, but that's not true.
Yeah, well, thanks. We've got Allison back with us now. Allison, you are on mute, so I'll let you know you can unmute yourself, and I'll hand it off to you, Allison, to thank Dean for the interview here on behalf of the CSPG.
Oh, were we going to ask what else I wanted to achieve?
Oh, yeah, wait. Yeah, Dean's still got more things to do. He wants to talk about that, I think.
Sure. Okay. All right. So, Dean, you've had a phenomenal career. What else is it that you'd like to achieve then?
Well, I guess that I guess I am running an oil company now. That wasn't quite what I planned, but that was the responsible thing to do. Company was in a little bit of trouble, and so I became the CEO. And so, tough times. I think that the decisions we've made has saved that company, and we'll do well. And so I want to see that. I want to prove that I can, in the times when the price of oil goes to as low as it did in 2020, we can survive, and we're going to grow, and we're going to grow through exploration. And that's, you know, I've got a good team behind me to do that. So I'm not looking to retire and leave that company. I want to make sure that it prospers, and so I'm sure it will. And I want to lead the whole team through the business of survival in this world, and through the geologists through the business of putting the best opportunities forward to grow. So that's one. I still when I do finally decide that I'm going to stop drilling, I've got some very interesting papers that I'd like to write, and Mandy, I hope, is going to be a co-author with me on it. But you say, well, why don't you start right now? And the reason I don't want to start right now, because I still have prospects to drill on those papers, so I'm not going to give those ideas away. And so that will come. I want to leave that information for future geologists, for young geologists to read, and like I did. And unfortunately, the exchange isn't as good as it was when I started in the business of papers and conferences and all that. But nevertheless, I'll find a way to get it published, and young geologists can read it.
That's great. Right. So we'll close here. Dean, I wanted to congratulate you on winning the 2020 Stanley Slipper Gold Medal. Thank you for sharing your stories and all your experience and advice. I mean, there's lots of takeaways here for anybody out there who's trying to struggle through some of these times right now. And it's great inspiration for Canadian petroleum geologists to get out there, as you know, follow your example, look at some rocks, and really chase their ideas and prospects. Thank you again very much.
And thank you for the honor of having the Slipper Award. It really means a lot to myself, and after a great career. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Jason. Thanks, Mandy.